I recently decided to go back to school. It's been pretty exciting. My whole life, though, has just been algebra and studying. Hopefully I get through the next couple of years, so I want to study psychology. Why I need algebra to study psychology is beyond me, but I'm excited, though. You know, for the past, like, 16 years, I've been playing music for a living and touring and doing things musically and working in studios and producing from home. I mean, what was I thinking? Playing music for the rest of my life and trying to have a steady income and raising a family and buying a home. That's ridiculous, right? I mean, anyways, here's Wonderwall. Aliens. Aliens. Fun fact, I think aliens are probably the scariest thing you can ever be afraid of. I think they're far more terrifying than any type of ghost or phenomenon or paranormal activity. I can handle gore and ghosts and horror, all kinds of stuff. Aliens, like being abducted, that keeps me up at night, literally. And I think it's the scariest thing in the world. Speaking of aliens, though, I mean, what's there to say that hasn't been said already about James Cameron's Aliens? It's a masterpiece. Most consider it to be the perfect movie, the perfect script, the perfect cinematography. I've been a gigantic fan since, just like everything else, I shoot these little films about talking about my favorite franchises. First saw the film and it literally changed my life. You have the best assorted characters, the best writing, the best setup in a story. I saw Aliens long before I saw any of the other Alien films of the franchise. It's still, to this day, easily favorited by all fans of every generation. I mean, when you look at the script and you look at the story of Aliens, it's perfect. You have the best character setups, you have the best supporting characters you can ask for, you have the best team-up, gung-ho, buddy, military film that also has a lot of fear and horror and suspense. James Cameron didn't go all in for the gore and the guts and the blood and the horror. He went in for the action. He went for the suspense of just a survival movie. Still to this day, I mean, I just saw Aliens recently in the movie theater just before 2020. It's even seeing it in the movies, it's a whole different film and it's so perfect. That movie was made to be seen in the theater. So if you ever have a chance to go see it, Definitely take that opportunity. But anyways, I'm not going to get too far into Aliens franchise or the film. What's said has already been said by billions and billions of other fans out there. Ever since I was a kid, I was obsessed with the visual style of the Marines. I love the style. I mean, the Terry English design of that armor, James Cameron influence from the Vietnam era of military. It works so perfectly. It works so beautifully, and it's a marriage of a visual concept that should be, well, actually still to this day, taken as an example for every film, such as the likes of Aliens. I remember being a kid watching Aliens and then going out and playing with my friends and putting on a life preserver and a toy helmet, you know, wishing I had that suit of armor and wishing I had those pulse rifles and everything. It sounds ridiculous, but I kind of made a vow to myself when I was young to one day own an actual suit of armor and uniform and pulse rifle at some point in my life. This is me talking about my armor. What I've done to get it and what I've done to it since I've had it, and how could you do the same thing? First, you're going to start with a pair of BDUs. The ones that I have are made by Proper. They're super, super cheap. Super cheap. And they're comfortable, they're durable, they do the job perfectly well. These particular pair that I use is used by many other Colonial Marine cosplayers or costumers. This is called Multicam Camo. It's pretty damn close to the movie-used BDU's pattern of the camouflage that they used. The camouflage that was used in the film was a custom-made camo. You cannot go online or to a store and just simply buy that. That was made specifically for Aliens, and it's really, really tough to find those. The BDU's. It's a shirt and a pair of pants. Not much to be said about it. Not much to be really looked over. But they are a military issue. They're super comfortable. You can, however, get a actual screen accurate pair of BDUs. There's only two guys that make them currently right now, as far as I know. That's Spatcave at Spatcave Studios, and there's another gentleman out in the UK, I believe he makes the BDUs. But if you really want to go that screen accurate, bring your wallet, because a good pair of screen accurate BDUs, I mean, you're on the upward swing of $800 just for the shirt and pants. Before armor, before props, before anything else, definitely around $800 to $900. So I did the cheaper route. Another option that you can have that a lot of guys recommend is the Polish Desert camo. That's a big fan favorite when it comes to another pair of BDUs you can wear. That looks pretty damn close to the screen use BDUs. I have a shirt, I don't have a pair of pants, and you know, when I got them, you know, once you start diving into building your own Colonial Marines costume or armor or such, you can lose your head with pretty much everything, especially starting with the BDUs. My advice, keep it simple, keep it cool. If it looks good to you, then it looks good. Keep that rule in mind for everything that you're gonna do. It's super hard to get something that really, really matches with the screen-used BDUs or the screen-used armor or the screen-used props even. When it comes down to painting or colorizing your whole outfit, keep in mind, James Cameron has a tendency of shooting film under black light and blue light. It's like, for an example, when you look at the armor and the pulse rifles, that was actually a best brown. It was a darker brown. Shooting it under black light and blue light, it comes out very green, very olive drab, basically. So every scene in that film, it might look a little different. Look at the scene on the Sulaco, where the Marines are just kind of hanging out and they're being briefed on their mission. The BDs that they're wearing are very bright, they're very tan, they're very gray, they're very all over the place. And then look at them when they're doing their complex sweep. Very different color, very darker, very kind of, there's a lot more browns, a lot more grays, and heavier and darker and thicker. So keep that in mind, especially with the pulse rifles and the armor itself. It's such a different color and almost scene to scene. 1 minute the pulse rifle's brown, the next minute the pulse rifle's green, the next minute the pulse rifle looks even black in certain scenes. Just keep an open mind and use the rule of, if it looks good to you, then it looks good. I spent months and months and months on the forums on Aliens Legacy, which is a great forum, which I recommend to anyone who's going to be diving into this stuff. A lot of the guys on there, because I just debated hard about what BDUs I should get, what paint I should use, a lot of them at the end of the day said, look man, if it looks good to you, it looks good, because there's really no wrong way of doing it. I mean, hell, if you really want to take inspiration by the Colonial Marines video game, I mean, everything comes in a different color in that game. So don't stress it, don't sweat it, just keep it simple and keep it easy. Alright, so you got your BDUs, you got your inner outfit. Next step is your armor. There's really three guys left who are making really, really good armor these days online. There's a lot of guys on Etsy, a lot of guys on eBay and stuff like that, and they offer 3D printed armor, and they offer paprika forms to make it out of foam, and some of them are even offer foam armor. There's so many out there though, and they all basically use the same files, so I wouldn't really waste my time or money on that stuff. They're all pretty much the same, and me personally, I think buying a suit of 3D printed armor these days, you're not going to have the strength and durability of a vacuum-formed armor, or especially an aluminum armor. If that's what you want to go for, definitely go for it. I just believe that there's better choices out there. The three guys that I recommend, currently, Terry English. Terry English is the guy who made the actual armor in the film. They are made of aluminum. They are made to your size. He will get the specs of your body size and design them and to make them fit for you, which is the proper way to get any type of armor made. Terry English is the man. He's done all the Colonial Marines armor from the movie Aliens. He did armor for Excalibur. He did work for the Mr. Freeze suit of Batman and Robin. To get an actual suit of armor made by Terry English is the ultimate, like, holy grail when it comes to alien prop collecting. So if you got the money and the patience, because the biggest problem that you're going to have with Terry English is that he's really, really, really hard to get a hold of. He's a really difficult guy to get a hold of. even just sending him through a simple email is near impossible. He does have a Facebook page, but it's just really difficult. And once you get a hold of him, be prepared to get your wallet out and spend a lot. An actual set of Terry English armor made and shipped to you, you're going to spend over $3,000 on this thing. So be prepared. If you really want to go all out and you got the dough to blow, definitely go for it if you can. However, keep in mind, it does not come painted. It's just raw aluminum. It does not come webbed or put together. You got to do the part yourself with webbing and riveting. It's the bare minimum when it comes to that type of stuff. So if you got the money, go for it, especially if you got the time on your hands to put it together and you know what you're doing and you have experience with this stuff, you're golden. Another guy that people recommend is from a site called goldenarmor.com. It's great stuff. It's a great suit of armor, and it's a great collection for Colonial Marines. However, I hear some ups and downs with Golden Armor. If you look on YouTube or look on the forums or even look on Facebook, a lot of people get their armor from Golden Armor, and it's a 50-50 chance when you might get disappointed from what you ordered. It is vacuum formed plastic. There's no aluminum at all. It is kind of misleading when you go to goldenarmor.com. It shows that it's put together and painted and ready to go, ready to wear out of the box. It is not. It is shipped in parts and pieces that you have to put together yourself. A lot of trimming of plastic, a lot of sanding of plastic, and then you have to web it together with your own webbing, and then using a rivet gun to slap all that together after painting it and clearing it and sealing it. Even the components of the helmet, of the microphone, and the camera and everything, it's all in little pieces that you gotta put together yourself. That's the big negative side of the Golden Armor. The plus side is that it's a little cheaper. It's about $600 for the whole kit of armor. It does ship pretty quickly because, like I said, it's shipped to you completely untrimmed, not polished up at all. Just here's the raw castings of your armor, and you gotta do the work yourself. If you're not experienced with working with plastic, if you're not experienced with a rivet gun and painting and building props in general, I do not recommend Golden Armor at all, just like many, many other guys don't recommend Golden Armor at all. And last but not least, the third option, which is the option that I went for, is Spatcave. Spatcave has been making armor for many, many years now. He is the go-to guy when it comes to alien Colonial Marines props in general. His armor is probably the most recommended armor that you can find in a simple Google search or forum or a group or Facebook. All Facebook groups recommend Spatcave. All the Colonial Marines groups across the world recommend Spatcave, and they proudly wear Spatcave. The benefit of buying a suit of armor from Spatcave is that it's ready to wear and ready to go right out of the box. There is no painting required, there's no riveting, there's no nothing required, really. He usually likes to put in a little extra work when you purchase a suit of armor from him. He'll put your last name on the chest plate and the back of the helmet if you wish. You can tell that his work, everything from his suit of armor to his pulse rifles to the welding tool, every little thing he does is made from passion of a fandom and passion of love. And I highly, highly recommend him. How I got my armor, Spatcave armor is pretty expensive. It'll set you back anywhere from $700 to $800 at the time when I ordered mine. I'm not sure how his prices are now. I was a Ghostbuster for many, many years. I had a Ghostbuster franchise of my own and a grouping that I would do with a couple friends. I had a Ghostbusters car, all the props, the uniforms, the proton packs, the whole nine yards. I fell out of it due to the community getting so very horrible and toxic, which I won't get into right now. In this film, I sold my main pack for just enough money to be able to afford a Spatcave armor to be made for me, and plus a couple hundred on the side to get some accessories. And so I basically traded my Ghostbusters gear for the Colonial Marines gear, and it is by far the coolest thing I've ever done and the best choice that I made when it comes to costuming and prop collecting. The downfall about Spatcave armor, it takes a long time. Don't order a set of armor from Spatcave expecting it to be shipped in 2 weeks to 2 months. I waited over a year for my armor to be made, built, and shipped to me. I made the biggest mistake, assuming that it was going to come very quickly. I remember I got the money together, and then I placed my order for my armor and everything I wanted, and then it all went through paid for, expecting to get it by, you know, 2 or 3 months. I emailed Spat, and he said, "Nah, bro, no." He says it's easily going to take over about a year, if not more, to get your armor sent to you. I was absolutely heartbroken, but it was definitely worth the wait, though. So keep in mind, don't order from him if you need it within a month to get it for your Halloween party. Order way, 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 way in advance. Since over the years, I don't know how long he takes now, I'm still seeing people online saying he takes about roughly about a year, if not just a hair sooner than a year. Like I said, I waited about 14 months for mine. However, it is worth every day of waiting. It is worth every second of waiting because it is by far probably my favorite costume that I own. And Spat is a really, really awesome guy. He's one of the nicest guys I've talked to when it comes to propping and prop collecting and building. Everything that I have, on the exception of my BDUs and my pulse rifle, has came from Spatcave because his work is just so perfect, and he's just such a cool guy, and throw things together for you. He'll help you out with any questions that you may have. Just don't bug him. When you order your suit of armor, don't bug him to keep asking him, "Hey, when's it gonna be done? When's it gonna be shipped to me?" Leave the guy alone. He has a lot to work on. Let him work, okay? It'll come when it comes. So that's it. Those are the three most popular choices to get a suit of armor these days, and I can't recommend Spatcave anymore. Terry English, if you got the money and you got the patience, if you want the same suit of armor made for you, that's the exact same armor that was built and designed for the film, definitely go for Terry English if you can get a hold of him. Golden Armor, if you're in a crunch and you want a nice project to work on and you love putting stuff together and spending a long time customizing stuff, definitely go for Golden Armor. But all three guys have their pros and cons, and the choice is up to you. So let's talk about the Spatcave armor. The armor itself, like I said, it's all vacuum formed plastic. It is really tough plastic, keep that in mind. It does bend, it is plastic, it will crack if you slam your body into a wall. Don't expect the same power of aluminum, but walking around in it, standing around in it, wearing it all day long at a convention, it's very, very comfortable, but it is vacuum form plastic, so don't expect the toughest thing, but it definitely looks the part. Spatcave paints them so perfectly. He does all of them by hand, the camo pattern, and also the weathering, the scratches, and the silver marks. That's all done by hand, by him. Perfectly, beautifully done. He does offer multiple patterns to choose from on his website. He has his movie camo, which is what I own. Basically the same color and camouflage as what you see as the armor in the movie. And then he has his own Spat custom version of the camouflage. And then he has black, and then he has off-green, and then he has all kinds of stuff. But it's pretty cool to have that option, though, when you order your suit. But yeah, it's basically that. The webbing is really, really tough. Army, military feeling issued webbing. I'm pretty confident that it'll hold my stuff together perfectly fine. It's not some cheap webbing that you buy at Walmart that's just spray-painted green, like I see a lot of guys offering with their suits of armors. The ab pad is actually pleather. It's not rubber, it's not a knockoff plastic or anything like that. It's not vinyl either. It's a pleather material. It is padded. It is kind of squishy, but it's super comfortable. The only thing you got to consider when you order your armor or when you first get the armor, okay, so your armor comes in the mail, it's in the box, you're excited, you're dying to put it on, you put everything away, you turn off your phone, everything, you want it to suit up and look at it and feel like Hicks or Hudson. Don't dive right into it so excited. When I first got my armor, I hated it because I felt like it didn't fit me. And then I learned that everything on the armor is adjustable with the webbing. Everything on the armor is so adjustable, so it forms and fits any body type. My first time wearing out into a convention, it was super uncomfortable, and it was super just kind of like a drag. When you first get your armor, take your time with it. The best way to do it is to adjust the webbing all the way out to the point where the armor is the biggest as it can go. and then just put it on you and then start tightening the shoulders, start tightening the sides, and then start tightening things so it's formed to your body. That's the proper way to get this done. The armor is not made for your body size. It's not made for your body at all, so it's going to be a little difficult. However, if you take time with it and play with the webbing and play with the sizing and the options that you have with forming it to your body, it fits perfectly and zero issues. Also keep in mind, I am 6'8". I'm 300 plus pounds. I am not the average guy who dresses up as a Colonial Marine, and this thing still fits me. My biggest concern when I was ordering my armor was I wrote to Spat saying, hey man, I'm a big guy. I'm 6'8", dude, and I'm a monster. I have a 54 inch chest. Is this thing even gonna fit me? Because when you're spending this much money on the suit of armor, you want it to fit you. He wrote me back and he says, I really don't have a straight answer for you. However, I have had customers who are about your size, if not even bigger, and they've had zero issues wearing it or putting it together for your body. Take time with it, spend time with it, adjust it to your body and your frame, and you are good to go. Modification that it did for mine was I didn't really touch anything. Everything was exactly how it was when I first came out of the box. The only thing I really did was the ab pad. The ab pad I had the most difficult time with. Basically, it locks around your waist, and then there's another loop that goes in between your legs and locks to the back. It's the same pad that you wear as a catcher or an umpire playing baseball. It goes between your legs, up your crotch, up your butt, and then straps to your back, and then it straps around your waist, and then there's this big black flappy thing. And try to get that straight and perfect, and then putting the armor on top of that so it locks in. I had a really hard time doing that. So I modified mine. I put a piece of webbing, I sized it, and I riveted to the very top of the ab pad, and I basically made it like an apron. I eliminated the bottom strap that goes between your legs, which is not accurate, I understand. But when it comes to comfort, and if you want to sit down wearing this thing, and if you want to walk around all day and not feel like you have a piece of camping webbing up your butt all day long, I highly recommend doing this mod. And the biggest plus side is that you can use the bathroom. By eliminating that middle piece that goes between your legs, you can use the bathroom if needed and not take off your whole suit of armor and then your ab pad and all that stuff. Very, very easy to work with. Very, very easy to modify. Once I did that, it changed the entire outfit. It fits so much better and it worked beautifully. It's things like that you might want to take a little time with and make sure you got your armor fitting properly. I did do a modification to my helmet. So here's my helmet. I added the little belt strap myself. You can get these on eBay, actual like Vietnam military issued ones for like $5, if not less. Definitely completes the look. Here's my alien button. I got that at Spencer Gifts one day, just found it for like $2. So this is what I modified. The microphone earpiece. It just kind of flops around. It would flop like all the way up. When you wear that, it's pretty out there. It's not pressed up flush against your ear. So what I did was, there is a piece of webbing behind the ear. I just clamped that so it stays straight up. And then I riveted that piece of webbing and I eliminated that way. It's just like this the whole time. And this microphone likes to bounce around a lot. Also, this is a plastic. I did not go for the steel pot version. At the time, I was really interested when I ordered it. However, Spatcave didn't have any available. And then Spat emailed me back saying, honestly, dude, you don't really want them. They're pretty gross and they're not really all that comfortable. He says, I'll put foam in your helmet and just make it much more comfortable. So the helmet is really, really comfortable. Microphone kind of can bounce up and down. I kind of like it how it just kind of hangs down like that. If you watch the film Hicks, his microphone's kind of sitting like that. So it was a Hudson. Hudson's helmet is like not even on his head sometimes. Sometimes it's like this. Sometimes it's like this. Sometimes it's like all over the place. Here's your lobster tail piece. This is all riveted and webbed into the helmet itself. Does a great job with this stuff. I mean, this helmet is a museum piece. I mean, this thing is pretty awesome. And I added my little flare. It's the coolest part about doing more Colonial Marine armor. You can add your own flair to it. You can add your own personality to it. And I thought that was pretty cool. It's an alien, given the peace sign. But that's the only thing I really modified was the ear flap, the earpiece, and the iPad. Other than that, it's completely straight, the same as it was when it came in the box and delivered to me. Another option, if you don't want to go for the helmet, because it does get pretty hot wearing that helmet, there's no air at all, sweat just drips down my face. But I think it's pretty cool because it kind of looks the part, since there's so much humidity in the alien hive. It kind of looks the part when you're just sweaty and nasty. But another option is a headset. Spat offers these. This is a little resin kit that just pops on like this. There is a wire that you can attach to it, and then it tucks down inside your shirt. This is just a quick, easy, and comfortable headset you can order from him. It's all resin with a metal rim and a plastic components here and there. You do have to build it yourself. It's actually quite a little fun little kit if you want to, especially if you want to never built a kit before and you want to build one. That does have a piece that clips onto here that actually does go inside your ear. I didn't attach that at all because I can't see that being really comfortable. But this is great for just walking around with no helmet on and just want to look the part as the second act or third act of the film. That's what Hicks is wearing. Jeanette Vasquez is wearing. It's quick, simple, easy. Spat offers these headsets pretty cheap too. These are also the headsets that was used in Star Wars. This is what Han and Chewie are wearing on the Millennium Falcon, and Luke when they're having their first space flight on the Falcon. If you find the real headset, a lot of money, really, really expensive, very, very collectible, very vintage, especially for the Star Wars fans who like to collect them, and of course the Aliens fans. But this is a cool little headset you can just wear without the helmet and be much more comfortable with no problem overheating. Or I live in Florida, so it gets hot down here a lot, and you really got to be careful with the costumes that you wear or that you make, because damn. Well, this has been fun. If camera died in mid-film and I couldn't tell, so I sat here and talked to a dead camera for about 10 minutes, and then I shot it again with a new battery and my microphone wasn't turned on. Anyways, where were we? So you got your BDUs, you got your armor, your helmet, your headset, whatever you choose. You need a weapon. One prop that people skip all the time, and it's a shame because it's a very, very important prop to have as a Colonial Marine: grenades. I wear 8 of these, 4 on each side of my straps and my chest. These are a very important part, an essential part in my opinion, as the Colonial Marine armor and costume. This is a resin cast made by Spatcave, coated in aluminum powder. When you buffer this with some steel wool, it gets really, really shiny and really pretty awesome looking machine made. The cap does come off, which is a big pain because these get lost all the time. It's a static prop, so the button does not work at all. There are some replicas out there that you can press the button. Well, this was made from a shotgun shell with a little snap cap on it. Another option that you can go for if you don't want to spend the money and get some resin castings of them: glue sticks. Go to the dollar store and get some glue sticks for like a couple bucks for a pack. In my first set of armor, I used glue sticks as my grenades, painted them silver, and the cap was red already. No one knew the difference. No one can tell the difference. And they looked awesome, actually. And that's definitely a tip I can share with you, and definitely a option if you want to save a few bucks and get some glue sticks at the dollar store and call them grenades. And you also need a main weapon. And the biggest popular choice is the pulse gun. This is the pulse rifle. Very, very iconic prop, probably one of the most iconic weapons in cinematic history. The pulse gun is definitely a fan favorite. A lot of people choose different weapons to carry for their Marine costume, and the pulse gun is by far the number one choice that pretty much everyone makes. This is a resin casting from a screen-used gun, so this is not really available to purchase anywhere. I scored this from a seller that happened to be on eBay, and it's a one-of-a-kind. Another option, a big option that people go for all the time, the most popular one, is the airsoft gun made by Evike or Snowwolf, I forgot their names. The airsoft gun will send you back about $300, but it's awesome. It's aluminum. It's actual usable. The LED counter does actually light up. It is a orange-tipped gun, so it is safe. However, I had one for a while, and carrying it around a convention setting, it really made a lot of people nervous. I would get my chops busted all the time with security and on-duty police officers all the time about it. It just was a headache when it comes to that type of stuff, which I am 1000% supportive in and understandable, because this day and age, it's weird seeing people carrying around guns in a convention setting, even if they're props or they're fake, but it makes a lot of people uncomfortable, so I respect everyone else. But it was a fun prop, and it was a fun gun to have on display for a while, but it was just too much of a pain, too much of a hassle, so I ended up giving it to a friend of mine who was a prop collector and a big Aliens fan. The other option is the Spulse gun made by Spatcave Studios. It's a resin kit. It's a lot of fun putting together. It's a really, really fun kit if you're into kit building. Completely resin. He adds a LED counter, any number from 1 to 99, he'll do customized for you. It's really, really cool. It's a really, really fun prop. I loved building it. However, my only issue with it was that it was a little undersized, and for my particular taste, it was just way too small, in my opinion. I'm a big guy, so pretty much every prop that I carry seems small to me. But, you know, when you watch the film, those guns are enormous to the actors. However, I do recommend them 100% because they are awesome, and they're very, very reliable and dependable. As I said, this is an actual resin casting from a screen-used gun. All the guns in the film were named. There was Alpha, Beta, Delta, Gamma. This is the Gamma gun. Every gun in the film had a different purpose. A lot of them were actual live firing. A lot of them were stunt foam guns. A lot of them were all different types of purposes and different scenes. As experienced prop building and collecting, when you see a gun in film and it's not shooting in that scene, 9 times out of 10, it is a non-firing prop. So they had to build a lot of pulse guns, and every single one of them was a little different from each other. A lot of them had different vent holes in the front here. A lot of them had no vent holes. A lot of them were static and solid. A lot of them didn't even have barrels, and they were just pieces of foam. They were all different from each other. The Gamma gun, which would be this one, the Gamma was made for background use. So a lot of it was used for the scene where the Marines were going through the hive on the Colonial complex. It was never meant to be firing, apparently, as far as I know. It's just a background gun. It was just there for looks. The counter never lit up. It was just a static counter. After filming, it was sold to a private collector. It was then repurposed for Alien 3, for the end of the movie where the soldiers showed up in the prison holding pulse rifles. Only one of those on that set was actually firing. The rest of them were dummies and prop. But this is one of those guns. So this is a third generation resin casting. It's a cast of a cast of a cast. This was available to purchase on eBay. Contacted the seller, got the history of it, and then I got the historical facts and it checked out. It is the Gamma gun. However, being that it's a recast, it's kind of frowned upon and shamed upon for prop builders and collectors. But I'm not really too worried about it because it was not recasted for production or to be sold. It was just recasted for a hobby, apparently. I think it was pretty cool, and the guy just happened to need the money and sell it, so I ended up buying it from him. It is one solid piece of resin, and this is really, really, really heavy. This is by far heavier than the airsoft gun and heavier than any other resin pulse rifle that I've held or owned. I added my own strap. This is a Cantina strap that you can get on eBay for like less than 10 bucks. These are picture frame holders. You can get those at Lowe's for like 2 bucks. And I just screwed it into the resin, and then lo and behold, it is very, very strong since it's one giant piece of resin. It is tough. The LED counter does not light up. It does not work. It's just a piece of paper I printed out and glued on there with a clear piece of plastic that'll make it look like a screen. But other than that, it is my favorite pulse gun that I've ever seen, and definitely my favorite that I've ever owned. But either way, it's one of my favorite all-time props, and it is friggin' heavy. What I like about it is that it's not perfect. The barrel is actually curving to the left, or my left, your right. And I like that though, because it's not perfect at all. It looks the part when you're holding it like this, but when you're holding it down on, you can see how curved it is, and it's actually pretty comical. Fun fact, this barrel for the grenade launcher actually broke off. This is a bottle cap from a water bottle. Completely broke off one day, and it was completely flat, and I needed a barrel, so I just took the cap of the bottle of water I was drinking at the time, flipped it in reverse, and I screwed it in there with a screw, and then I filled that up with some resin, and lo and behold, I got myself my barrel back for my grenade launcher. So there's my pulse gun. those are the weapons. There's plenty to choose from. It's whatever you're comfortable with. Like I said, a lot of people even skip over the weapon and they just hold a motion tracker if you just want to feel cool. What's next? Well, another step further is the shoulder lamp. This is a resin kit made by Spat. This is the lamp that goes over your left shoulder. Out of everything on a set of Colonial Marine armor, this is the most difficult. I will say that with confidence. It's a fun kit to build, a pain in the ass to maintain, and a pain in the ass to try to mount yourself. These are aluminum brackets that were made for me by Spat. He offers these on his website. One clips onto here, which has been riveted to the back here, and two other pieces get riveted to the back of the armor. The coolest part, though, about this prop is it is functional. It is an actual working light, and it's an actual working lamp, which makes it pretty cool. I don't really don't see it being all that useful in a convention setting, but if you're doing like a Halloween event or some kind of party or something like that, it is pretty cool to have that. My downfall is that I am so tall, 6'8". When this is turned on, it's usually blinding people right in the face, so I kind of angle mine upward a little bit so it's not blinding people, but it is pretty cool just to have that effect. You can reenact this in a dark room, just like how it looked in the film when they're doing the complex sweep, and it's a fun little prop, and they're pretty awesome. Supposedly the ones on the set, when they were turning on and actually used for lighting on the set, they only lasted like 10 minutes or something like that, and then they had to change the batteries, which is pretty remarkable. This is powered by two C batteries or D batteries, I can't remember. Really, really big batteries. This is hollowed, so they're kind of bouncing around in there. They're completely wired together. The wiring part is part of the kit, and it's very, very easy to do. There's no soldering required. You just gotta drill the holes in the resin to feed them through, and then they clip together. But it is definitely a one step further. I'm still not done with this. I would like to repaint it, and I would like to weather it and fix the light a little bit. Spat does offer these in multiple bulbs. This is the actual bulb. He does make a LED version. The actual bulb version, though, is what they used in the film. And it has a very warm, kind of orangey, kind of tan tint to it, which is what I wanted if I ever were to use this. The LED version that he offers does not have that. It's more of a blue, more of a white color, and a lot more brighter. I hardly ever turn this thing on. It just sits there for looks, and it's just there for appearance. It's never, ever turned on, ever. Especially in a convention where it's really brightly lit. It's kind of pointless to be walking around with this turned on. It just looks cool, and it's a little added detail effect in the film. But I do definitely recommend a shoulder lamp. That's pretty much it. The only thing left is pouches for your belt. There's no uniform setting for the Colonial Marines, so the pouches are whatever you prefer them. I carry a pistol holster on my right side because that's what Hudson had and a few other Marines. The other pouches I bought off of eBay for like $3, $4 a piece. It's convenient to me. It holds your cell phone, it holds your belongings, your wallet, and stuff like that when you're in a convention setting. That's the best part about this armor. You customize it the way you want it and wherever you is comfortable to you. But that's pretty much it. That's all I can really say about the armor. I really, really hope you enjoyed the video. A lot of people don't have a video of their Spatcave armor. I love it. I think it's worth it. But I recommend it to anyone. Spat is the best, in my opinion, when it comes to alien props, alien costuming, everything from his armor to his little belt props to his BDUs. I mean, he is the man, and I can't recommend him more than enough. Same as 100,000 fans out there who are doing the same thing as I am with the stuff. But it's a lot of fun. If you want to get a set of armor, go for Spat. I recommend it 1,000%. If not, Terry English or Golden Armor are really, really good choices. Just pros and cons between them all, as I said. But yeah, that's it. I hope you enjoyed this little video, and this is me showing off more of my cool stuff. What more can I say? Aliens kicks ass. Colonial Marines kicks ass. I'm excited for the new game. That's what made me want to put this video up. Really excited for the new game, actually. The whole outfit and armor is by far one of the most cherished props that I have in my collection. So yeah, this is me showing off my alien stuff, and I hope you enjoy it. Leave a like, comment, subscribe, the whole jazz, or not, whatever, it's fine. But thanks for watching, and catch you later.